Okay, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our afternoon session. So this morning we looked at this idea of convolutional neural networks. We said, what happens if you have an image and you're interested in matching a pattern that can be moved around, and you want to recognize a hand over here and a hand over there, and maybe there's an efficient way of limiting your weights down to smaller sections that you can reuse spatially around the image. Okay? So this morning we were looking at this idea of looking at spatial data, right? In this afternoon, we're going to be looking at temporal data. We're going to be saying, what happens if you have some sequence over time that you would like to deal with? And so this afternoon, Stefan and I will be speaking about recurrent neural networks and various gated architectures as well that you can use to solve these problems. So in the first part, we'll be looking at some of the intuition. We'll be saying, what is an RNN? How do they work? How do you train them? How are they different to feed-forward networks, etc.? And then in the second part, we'll be looking at some gated architectures. And these gated architectures help solve some of the problems that are associated with very deep networks that we're going to be looking at in the first one. Finally, at the end, Stefan will be talking about some of the applications that you can use these RNNs for. So, let's start off with what we know. We've been talking a lot about neural networks, feed-forward neural networks, right? And so we saw this image earlier, and basically what we're doing is we're saying we have some image of an 8. We have a 28 by 28 pixel image, and that contains an 8. We unroll it into some long vector, and we use all of those as inputs into our network, right? We then say, take all of those, multiply through by the weights, calculate the activation function. Multiply through by weights, activation function. Weights, activation function. And the signal goes from the input layer and propagates all the way through to the end until we get right to our output layer and we can read off our result using softmax or something like that, right? So what's important in this model is that we gave an input and it gave us an output. And that was it. It was some closed function. It didn't remember anything from the previous time we used it. It didn't say, hey, last time we saw an 8, so maybe this one's also an 8, or think about what you would do in this problem if we said, well, what do you do for two numbers? Do we now train a brand new neural network on now images that are twice as wide? That's great. We can now solve the two-digit problem. Now, what if we want the three-digit problem, right? Or the four, or the five? Or you want some unknown length sequence. And so you want to be able to say we need a new architecture that will allow us to keep giving it new data. And that you can read this data, and then eventually say, okay, here's an answer at the end. Or here's an intermediate answer in the middle. And we'll look at what some of those structures can be. But the big idea is that we need to be able to remember some state from previous time steps. So in the feed-forward model, there's no state, we don't remember anything, we turn on the neural network, we give it input, and it gives us the output. In the RNN and in these sequence modeling approaches, what's important is that we can give it data, it remembers some state, and it updates that state with new data. So you can kind of think of it as broken telephone with yourself, and hopefully not broken. Okay? So you start off with something in mind. Okay? I have some state in my mind, and I'm just sitting thinking about it, and then someone comes and tells me something. And I get some input, and that probably updates my thought patterns. It probably updates what's in my brain. Okay? Then what I do is I now have a new internal state. Someone else can tell me something, and I can get another reading, and that updates my state. And then someone else can tell me something, and that updates my state. And then right at the end, when people are finished talking to me, then I can reply, and I can be like, here's an out. This is what I was thinking. So that's the basic intuition. We have an internal state, we take new inputs, they update the internal state, and then we can calculate some output based on that. So the first question is, why don't we just use convolutions for that all the time? And so if you imagine we had the image, And we said you can have an image that moves around, and you can have convolutions at different points, and you can handle multiple pixels next to each other and in different places, right? But that convolution is a fixed size. So again, we're stuck with that idea of a fixed length sequence. And for example, if you look at this sentence, so this is Michael C. was born in Paris, France. He is married and has three children. And he has received an MS in neurosciences from the university. And it tells us a whole lot about that history and where he's moved around and what he's done. And then it says, what is his mother tongue? Yeah? And the first time I read that sentence, I was like, I don't even know. I had to go back and look at the very beginning of the sentence, right? Because right at the very, very beginning, it said, born in France. Okay? So probably French, if we're trying to predict the next word in that sentence, right? And so if we have a convolution moving over that sentence, we might have a convolution that starts with the first couple of words, and then it considers more words as it moves along. But it wouldn't remember the state right from the very beginning. So if we want these long-term dependencies, we need to have some other way, and that's why we need to remember this other state. All right? So, if we go back to our original example, okay? Here's our original example. We have an input, we want an output. One input, one output, no sequences. We can just use the feed-forward model. There's nothing too crazy there that we need to think about. But what if we want to solve a problem like this? If we're doing image captioning, right? We can have one input, so one image, and maybe we want the neural network to tell us this person is wearing a straw hat. Right? Maybe we want it to tell us varying amounts of data. It says, I can see a guy there, it looks like he's outside. If it's telling us a whole sequence of information about the image. Right? So we can have this other type of model where we have one input, but we want a sequence of outputs. So we can then swap that around, right? We could say, what if we have a sequence of inputs, but we only want one output at the end? Okay? And so one example of that you can see is actually with image processing, where we can take a big image, we can break it up into small pieces, and we feed those smaller pieces into the network. The network remembers what it's seen so far, builds it into some kind of internal state, and then right at the very end, once it's seen everything, it tells us the final answer. Okay. We could also do things like if I gave it a sentence of input, and I just wanted a yes-no answer right at the very end. That would be a similar kind of thing. The next one is a sequence to sequence. So many inputs, many outputs. And what's important in this one is that we read all of our inputs first, then we stop, and we get all of our outputs. There's a sequence to start with, and then a sequence at the end. Is there any ideas when this might be useful? Translation, right? I give you a sentence in English, it goes into the machine, it comes back, and we get a sentence in whatever other language we want. Right? So even translation falls under this kind of model. And then the last one that you might want to think about is many inputs, many outputs. But you start getting inputs and outputs at the same time. So I give you an input, you give me an output. I give you another input, and you give me a second output. Another, and you keep iterating like that. And so at every time step, you can get both a new input and then a new output. So these are some of the different types of sequences that you might want to model. And these are something that you need to think about when you're working with RNNs, when you're working with sequences in general. So back on our original example, if we want to classify numbers, okay? If we're in the feed-forward section, we get a 1, we classify it, we see it tells us it's a 1. We can do something with that, right? We give it a 9, it tells us it's a 9. We give it a 2, it tells us it's a 2. But there's no way for the model to say 1, 9, 2. There's no way for it to say this was actually one number that's much bigger. We could build on something extra afterward, but in this case we're saying we want the actual learning model to be able to capture the sequence idea. So when we talk about an RNN, what we say is we give it some input, and that input updates the state inside. So in this model on the right-hand side, you can see we've got some input, The inputs go in just like a normal feed-forward network, and somehow the network remembers that it's seen a one. Right. Then on the next one, we somehow need to say, well, we need to remember what the previous state was, and we need to take some new input. Okay. And that's what's illustrated on the left-hand side of the slide. You can see how we have some input that goes in. We have some hidden state that wraps around. So really, there are two inputs into our cell. The one is our new input. The other one is the previous state. And so at every time step, we just need to know what was the previous state, what is the new input. And so when we then see our second number, that gets input into the network. And the network is now saying, we have some input over here, and we've also input our previous state from the last time step. And then the network takes all that information and says, okay, we saw a 1 before, so we must remember that, and now we're seeing a 9, and it updates its state to say we've seen a 1 and a 9. Similarly, when you go to the third one, you say, now we've seen a 1 and a 9, we are now seeing a 2, and somehow it must update its internal state to say we've now got 192. All right. So if you're designing something like this, we're basically saying we need some recurrent function. Our function is calculated using values at the current time step, at the previous time step. All right. But how is the previous time step calculated? Time step before that, right? And the one before that, and all the way back to the beginning, right? To the very beginning of our sequence. So that's why we say it's recurrent. Okay? So it takes in the previous state, it takes in x, and then we have our recurrent function of some sort, and it gives out some output that we might use further on in the network if we're building more Lego blocks on top of it. And then it also remembers its state that should wrap around and come back once it sees another observation. So, in general, we have a computation graph that looks like this. Our computation graph says we have x coming in, we have some function, some activation function as normal, we probably have multiple neurons and weights and things like that, and then we also have that previous state that wraps around. And you can see on this slide that extra weight wrapping around, you must just note that it takes one time step for that to get back. Okay, so that one's always one time step behind. And then finally, right at the very end, we can calculate y based on that hidden state. So what the easy way to think about this is to unroll the graph. So rather than trying to think of this one cell where we have loops and loops and loops, okay, we can say that at the very, very beginning, we have h naught, where it's some hidden state inside h naught. Right at the beginning. From there, we see an input, x1. And we use h0 and x1 together in some function. And that takes us to some new state, h1. That h1, if we want, we can then use to generate some output. So if we're in the case where we want an output every time, it will look like this. Otherwise, if we only want an output at the end, then we wouldn't have anything there, right? So we're now there. We then see a new x. So now we see x2. Well, we say we're at hidden state h1. We get some new observation. We take both of those things into our recurrent function. It updates our new state to something else. And potentially, if we want some output, we can get that. And so we keep doing that with x3 and 4 and 5 all the way until we get to the end of our sequence. And this is the idea behind RNNs, is that you have one network, one set of parameters, and we've repeated them multiple times. All right? So every time we had an application of this activation function, every single time it was the same parameters theta. Okay? So all of those weights are shared between every instance of the unrolling. And so as we get longer sequences, this unrolling can get longer and longer and longer. And so in a lot of the other talks, we've been thinking about networks being deep because we have lots and lots of layers. In RNNs, they can be deep because your sequences can be long. If you have 100 items in your sequence, then you unroll it 100 times. Okay? And that has an impact on training. And all the same problems you might have with vaulted layers, you can potentially have with this. And then we remember that this is one Lego block that we're using to build everything else as well. So this can be one layer in many as well. All right, so that important part, it's the same parameters every time. And so when we want to do training, and we want to train going backwards from the output, calculating our loss, calculating our gradients, backpropagating through all these layers in time, we're talking about the same parameters at every step. All right. So, yes, question. So we have all of these y's, and we need to think carefully about how you associate them back into an error. And Stefan is going to talk about that a little bit more later on, so I won't jump ahead to that for now. Okay. All right, so we have some feed-forward API, right? We've seen what those will look like. We'll have some forward function. We'll take in some input, and it'll give us a result, right? So in our feed-forward network, we're basically saying we have some weights that map x into our hidden layer. We add some bias, and we run it through an activation function. We then take the value, which then is now the output of our hidden layer, and we might run that through some other layer. So we could do softmax, or in this case, we've just had another linear output. Okay, with another set of weights. So we've seen that before. We understand how we can train that. In the RNN, okay, we're doing a similar thing. It's just like before, but now we've added an extra term inside that call. So when we call our activation function, we've got this extra term, and we've got a set of weights, and it takes us from our previous states into our following states, just like before. So we have the same kind of activation function, right? And we're taking our input with its weights. We're taking our previous state with its weights. We add them together, we send it through our activation function, and it gives us our new state. From there, if we want to calculate an output, we just take that and we have weights associated there that we could also load. When we're running forward through an entire network, we're now no longer giving it a single observation. We're not saying here is the image or here is the sequence of words coming. We're saying an entire sequence. Okay? So we're not saying a handful of words, we're saying a whole sequence of words. Okay? We're saying a whole sequence of pictures or a whole sequence of images. And so when you're running forward in this case, and you can see just here's this unrolled graph, we have a for loop. We have our data and a label. Yeah? And we run them forward in the first one. That updates our state. We then go to the next item in our sequence, and we update our state in the next item. And so we have this for loop over all of the different observations in our sequence. We call our recurrent function multiple times, and just in the interest of efficiency, we store the y and we store the hidden state inside, that internal state. So for those who prefer the maths, this is what it looks like. We have some function, we have our weights, we have our x, and we have our bias. That's what the feedforward looks like. And what we said is for the RNN, it's exactly the same thing, but we have the extra term that takes into account our previous state and the relevant weights for that. And so those weights affected at every time step, and the current weight depends on all previous time steps, the current value depends on all previous time steps before, and so those recurrent weights means that we need to think slightly differently about our application of backpropagation and how we apply our chaining. So we've basically looked at how to do forward propagation now, and it's this composition of functions. And so when we now want to do training, we need to think about how to apply the chain rule and how to apply backpropagation through all of these steps in time. And for that, Stefan is going to come and present.
Okay, so Richard has had the fun part so far of telling you how we go in the forward propagation phase to get to the stage where we have an unrolled graph. Also, just to get back to the gentleman's question at the back there, why do we have that Y only at the second time step? There are many different options that you can do, and it depends on the task that you're actually trying to model. If you are, for instance, and we'll look at this a little bit later when we get to applications, but if you are, for instance, doing language modeling, you might generate the first word directly from the first state, and then use that feedback to generate the next word or to compute the probabilities of the next word. So we'll get to that a little bit later. In that graph that we show, we actually just show if I give you an input X and I require you to generate a label Y, then I first need to see the input before I can generate the label. And that's why that Y was a second. So the question we have now is, we've done forward propagation. And importantly, we arrived at a fully unrolled state of the graph where we've saved all these intermediate activations and outputs of the model. How do we now update the parameters in order to train this model so that it becomes better at predicting whatever task it is that we care about? And the short answer is there's multiple different ways of actually training these weights, just like with feed-forward models. The simplest way of doing this is simply saying, I'm not going to train weights. It sounds crazy, but there's a type of recurrent neural networks called echo state networks, where you just need to carefully initialize these recurrent parameters, and then the only thing you train is how to predict the labels from these internal states. And that's the simplest case. In this case, it used to be quite popular, but with the advent of backpropagation and frameworks like TensorFlow, which helps a lot with unrolling the graph, backpropagation through time has become the algorithm of choice. There are other examples as well, but for this lecture, we will just focus on understanding how backpropagation through time works. So that's what I said about echo state networks. Essentially, you initialize your weights. You want there to be a lot of dynamics in the model, and then you just train the output weights. So with backprop through time, there's this. It's very similar to doing standard backpropagation. So I'll quickly review standard backpropagation in the feed-forward case, and then we'll see how it differs when we consider sequences over time. So when we go from depth in the spatial dimension to depth over time. If you recall, for a feed-forward model, let's say we take the same model where you have an image 8 in the layer at the bottom, we do several forward propagations. That leaves us with activations on the hidden layer. We have an output prediction, which we use to create a loss function. If we do probabilistic modeling, we might use the cross entropy. And then we apply the chain rule backwards, just to get the gradients of this loss with respect to each of the intermediate weights. We use that with a gradient-based optimizer to train weights. An RNN is very similar. You can think of an RNN in a very similar way to thinking about deep feed-forward models. Where your feed-forward model is deep, if you just kind of flip it over so that the layers correspond to the time steps, then a lot of the intuition carries over. There's just a couple of differences. The one is we need to keep in mind that the prediction at every time step of this model contributed to the error that we're measuring at the output. So therefore, when we backpropagate from the loss function, we need to somehow update the parameters of all of these individual time steps. The second thing is because we reuse the same recurrent weights, these weights are basically shared over time, there's an additional phase where we will have to consider all of these gradients together, so it will become the sum of these gradients. In theory, we want to train an RNN over the entire sequence. We want to unroll it over all time sequences, generate the loss function, and then backpropagate to all the weights. In practice, however, as we saw, if you remember back from showing the code, or if you think about how we do fprop, we need to save these intermediate activations of the model at each time step. We also need to save the predictions. So having a model like this, which is unrolled over, for instance, 100 time steps, keeping around 100 copies of feed-forward networks. And this is expensive because memory is limited. So what we end up doing in practice is we don't actually unroll over the entire sequence. We use an algorithm called truncated backpropagation through time. The basic idea is we take our full sequence, we chop it up into smaller, equally length sequences. So if this was a long sentence that we wanted to model, we consider the first 10 words, for instance, unroll our model over those words, backpropagate through those words, and then we move on to the next chunk. But we keep the hidden state of the model that we arrived at the end of the first 10 units. This is called backpropagation through time, and what it allows us to do is it allows us to have a constant memory footprint. So we will take our full sequence, chop it up into segments, and then consider each of these segments in turn. So just to summarize again, at the end of fprop, we have an unrolled graph. We have inputs x propagated forward through the network, activations all the way on the hidden layers. And with a backpropagation through time, we're trying to calculate the derivatives of the error at the end and use that to update the events. So the way that works is, the first step is to actually calculate those errors. And depending on the task that we're doing, again, if we're trying to label the individual words in the sequence, we might have these intermediate predictions, each one could give us a loss. But also if we're trying to label an image as belonging to some kind of class, we might just have a prediction at the end. However it may be, we end up with these error terms, and we want to figure out how to propagate them back into the weights. And again, the key concept here is that these weights are all shared. We keep applying the same function over the entire recurrence. To delve a little bit deeper into that, let's just consider a fixed length, an arbitrary fixed length sequence of the graph. So imagine we're at time step t, ht, and here I'm only showing the graph for the previous two time steps, ht minus 1, ht minus 2, and then we have those two inputs there. And in fact, let's simplify this a little bit further by just dropping, not showing the application of the function, removing the inputs, and this is what we work through. In fact, we'll make it a little bit simpler. Let's not even consider those intermediate labels either. So this is what we're sitting with at the moment. We have an arbitrary sequence of the unrolled graph, and we're trying to figure out how do we backpropagate through this thing. So as we said, the first step is we calculate the error. So this would be, for instance, your cross-entropy function. That gives us an error at time step t. Now how do we propagate errors back from e back into theta? Well, we know that the error is a function of ht, of yt, and yt is a function of ht. And we know that we can compute the derivatives of dE with respect to ht. We've done this several times already for feed-forward neural networks as well. So this gives us the contribution of the error of et on the last hidden layer, ht. And now we can do the same thing. We know that ht is actually a function of f theta, which is an application of f theta, which is a function of theta. So we can just compute the derivative of ht with respect to this theta. And then by the chain rule, we have the total gradient of the error with respect to theta. So we have what we wanted to obtain. So we can train our model, right? In fact, no, because there's this other condition that ht actually depends on ht minus 1, our previous time step. And because our previous time step is also a function of theta, we need to keep that in mind and consider that path as well. So now we're done. Well, actually, if we can continue unrolling this logic, you'll see that this error actually unrolls and unfolds all the way through the network. Because each time step, each state depends on the previous state, which is a function of theta, and we need to consider that graph through the network as well. In fact, if we generalize this a little bit, for the people who like to see the math a little bit more, the total gradient of the output error with respect to theta is actually the sum over all of these intermediate paths and the application of the chain rule. So it's the sum of dv, dht, that's the first term over there, and then dht, dh theta, dE, dht, dht, dht minus 1, dht minus 1, dht minus 2, and all of these, they're partial derivatives with respect to theta. We sum over all of these parts. And the important thing to notice here is that this term right there, the derivative of the current time step with respect to the previous time step, this actually results in this product over increasingly longer sequences. And this will be, I'm just pointing it out now, but this will become an issue with training RNAs. This repeated multiplication, in order to get a gradient, we need to do this repeated multiplication of derivatives between time steps. It ends up creating problems for training the RNA, and we'll see why in a little bit. There's one more step that we need to do, and that is that we may actually have intermediate errors as well. So just to take a step back, what we considered now was just the derivative. Yes?
So if you have, let's say, that error and your intermediate errors, and you have in your sequence one label that occurs more, so sort of a pass imbalance with respect to one thing in your sequence, won't you then calculate gradients for every time that increases and sort of artificially make the gradient for that object bigger? So like almost like a pass imbalance in a normal network, but now it's just over time.
Well, if we use this within stochastic gradient descent to train a probabilistic model, if that class is imbalanced, it will learn the distribution that is in the data. So you will end up learning the right thing. Just to summarize again what we have here, what I've shown here is just the unrolling for an arbitrary segment of our graph of one error at time step t and how it depends on all the previous time steps. And now we add in, let's say we're doing something where the model is producing labels every time step, and we're scoring them as correct, or we're scoring them as incorrect, and we get an error from that as well. The total error that the model makes over the entire sequence is in fact the sum of all of these intermediate errors. So the only extra thing you need to keep in mind is that we need to get the total gradient of the fully unrolled graph with respect to the shared parameters data. We just take this formula and we sum over all of the errors in the time step. The total error is a sum of all errors, so the total gradient is a sum of all gradients. For each of these sums, this is what we looked at there, the application of these chain rules through longer, progressively longer graphs. Yes?
There's something I don't quite get to this, rolling back. Let's say that when I'm training this, it just so happens that my samples are maybe like 10 characters long, so I usually train this stuff that is 10 characters long. But why does it work when it's 11 or 12 or 9?
I see. It works because you are using, you're applying the same function every time step. So you're actually training a model to be able to map from any arbitrary time step to any next time step. So if you change that sequence, it is just, it's just a reapplication of the same recurrent function. And this function, through training, have learned the correlations between the individual time steps, so you can learn to map from one time step to the next. The fundamental insight in RNNs is that we don't need to specify the length of the sequences. So it's kind of like saying we don't need to specify the depth of the network. We can just continue unrolling it if we want more layers. But the analogy doesn't work correctly because there's also these inputs in the media, but it's one way of thinking. No. It does not. Because let's say if we're modeling a sequence, we'll get to that in a little second, but we could model the conditional distribution of the current label given everything before it. So if we do language modeling, we could say, I want my model to learn the joint probability of all words in language. And that is clearly not independent. But you can decompose this over time steps by applying the product rule. I could say P
of x1 and x2 is the product of p of x1 given x2 times p of x2. Or actually the other way around if we move forward in time. So p of x2 given x1 times p of x1. If you keep doing that, you end up learning all of these relationships between the labels together.
You have a
theta
there. For the hidden state, for the...
No, the theta is for the parameters we use to generate the hidden state.
Yes, and what about the inputs as well? Is that also...
Okay, very good question. So for now, just think about theta as the combination of mapping from inputs to hidden and from hidden mapping to hiddens to hidden. Because you can actually think about it that way. I'll show you in a couple of slides, actually a few from now, I'll show you how you can just stack these two together and consider it as one matrix multiplier, where the components of the matrix would be mapping from input to hidden normally and hidden to hidden. So it's both of those. Okay. So what this says to us, essentially, is it's saying that because we're sharing the weights over time, the total gradient becomes a sum over all time steps. There's a little caveat in there, which is because of this sum, the lengths keep on getting longer and longer, and we also keep on computing the same chain rules, the same chains of derivations. So the innovation of backpropagation through time is the same thing as the innovation of standard backpropagation. Getting gradients is an application of the chain rule. But if you do it naively, then for every layer, you'll start again at the top and compute the chain up to the current layer. At the next layer down, you'll start at the top again, recompute everything, and the next one. So you keep on adding one to the chain. Backpropagation essentially says, we can cache these things. We can save these computations. And the way to think about it is the following. If I ask you to compute 1 plus 2, you'll say 3. If I ask you to compute 1 plus 2 plus 3, you'll say 5. If I ask you to compute 1 plus 2, 6, sorry. if I ask you to compute 1 plus 2 plus 3, wait, plus 4? At some point you'll realize that you can just save the computations you've done so far and just add the new element that I'm giving you. And hopefully you'll do better than I did. That's essentially, that idea is dynamic programming. That idea is we don't have to recompute things from scratch. If I have a problem that can decompose into similar calculations, I can do those calculations once and save them. So I'm trading memory for computation. And that's how this works as well. So what I'm showing here is the algorithm for backprop through time. And you don't need to know Python in order to basically understand this. There's one main issue, one main idea here, and this is in order to calculate the total gradient going through our unrolled network, we start by calculating the forward function on the inputs and the labels. That gives us a loss and caches. And again, caches is just these saved states. That state, that state, that state, and the predictions of the model, right? Given this forward calculation, I can then initialize my dynamic program. I can say the gradient on H is initialized as zeros. We start with a blank state. And now, and my gradients are also zero. And now, starting at T, going from all the way from T, that should be a T, all the way down back to 0 or 1, we just do this backwards application of the chain rule. And the nice thing about that is it decomposes locally into this Lego block that we talked about earlier. What it does is it allows us to just consider the gradients that is local to this time step. So what we do is we start from the back and we say compute the derivative with respect to ht and save that in grad, and we then save that in our grad dictionary. This saving happens over and over for every time step. So at the next time step, remember we've updated this dh next. What is dh next? Dh next is the derivative of the error with respect to the time step that we just came from. It's the saved computation. It's the part of the chain rule that we're not recomputing.
this is saying exactly the same thing. So earlier we saw that the total derivative of the total error with respect to theta is the sum over all of the individual errors and their derivatives with respect to theta. So we keep on doing this all the way backwards, summing the gradients from this local block together, and that gives us the total gradient of the network. So the main thing to keep in mind here is, again, because we have these shared thetas, we have to sum gradients. And because we recompute similar chains of the chain rule, we can save that and save that computation. So what is the complexity of this algorithm in terms of sequence length? How much computation does it need? If we have a sequence of length t, and I'll tell you, we'll give you a hint, f prop is of order t. We're not considering weights and all the other things. We have to do t individual computations. What would this algorithm give us for the gradients? Okay, ignore this. Let's just say you can write this as a single instruction saying, save this. T, it's linear. So backpropagation through time is a linear time algorithm for getting these gradients. Why is that such a big advancement? Why is that such a breakthrough? Because if we were to directly apply the chain rule, we would go dE, d final layer for the first derivative, then again dE, d final layer before that, then again dE, d final layer before that, and deeper and deeper and deeper. And you'd actually get an algorithm that is quadratic in the depth of a network. You'd get an order t squared algorithm. So for the people who think about computational complexity, the saving of the gradients allows us to compute these really efficiently. Okay, so now we know how to forward propagate and get outputs, and we know how to backwards propagate and get gradients. Seems like it's a wonderful model, right? Suddenly we can map from sequences to sequences, we can map from input sequences to output labels for each of them. Why is this not being used everywhere? Or why was it not being used everywhere? Turns out when you just go and apply this in practice, there is a little issue. The issue is that these models in theory can remember all of the past, but in practice, there's an issue of vanishing and exploding gradients. Why is that? So this is coming back to one of these gentlemen's questions earlier of what is theta? Is it the input weights or the next weights? Let's write theta or W. Let's write theta as W. This is our transfer function, or recurrent function, for going from time step t minus 1 to time step t. We take the previous time step, we take xt, multiply both with a wxh and a whh, and that gives us the new time step. You can show to yourself, you can work it out a little bit by going through the math. You can actually put these two matrices together, concatenate them, and stack these two states, h and x, and do this as one multiply. So now we have just one recurrent matrix W. So you can go check that. That works out. What is the problem with this? If we backpropagate from time step t minus t to time step t minus 1, again, I'm not going to go through the derivation, but the practicals are quite detailed. They show the details of this. It turns out that going from the error at time step t back to t minus 1 results in an application of this recurrent matrix. In fact, transpose of that. If you think back to Mark's lecture, we had a function mapping from m to n. The gradient will be m to m, n by m. It's the same thing in this case. You just have the transpose of the forward function. So the gradient is this repeated multiplication of the recurrent weights. Why could that be a problem? As we extend the sequence length, the number of times that we multiply this error by a matrix increases, gets longer and longer and longer. So what do we know about, let's not think about matrices. Let's say our RNN had a single real number for a hidden state. In that case, going from HT back to HT minus 1, multiply that with a single weight. What do we know about multiplying numbers with a weight that is less than 1? If I go the same weight, remember we're sharing weights, so
going the same way. Some number multiplied by W. All of us have played this game on the calculator. You start with something, you go multiply, boom, you go equals. If that number is smaller than 1, it quickly tends to 0. If that number is larger than 1, it quickly explodes. That, in essence, is the issue of vanishing exploding gradients. It's just the matrix case. In the matrix case, we kind of quantify the size or the mapping of this matrix in terms of its singular values. If the singular values are larger than 1, we end up with exploding gradients, and we get nonce, not a number, and this is not useful. You cannot train a network when you get nonce. And if the singular values are less than 1, we end up with vanishing gradients, so it goes to 0. So there's no training signal. So you cannot update those weights. So this is the issue. As you try to propagate these weights deeper back into the network, the gradient, the training signal, falls to 0 or it becomes undefined. And this is what has plagued RNNs. For years, people didn't know how to really train them on any interesting data. It turns out that dealing with exploding gradients is not really that big of a deal. If your gradients get bigger than a certain size, you can just reshape, you can just normalize them again. So typically you'll just implement this as saying if my recurrent weights during the update gets the norm of my weights get bigger than some number, divide by that number, bring it back to 1. That's easy to deal with. And that's showed in that little code snippet. But dealing with vanishing gradients is much harder because the training signal dies. And it turns out that one of the most successful ways that people have discovered to deal with this is actually changing the architecture of the RNA. It's actually introducing gating functions, which Richard will talk about in the next section. But the basic idea is the model can selectively choose to keep around hidden states, and the converse of that is it ends up having an uninterrupted gradient flow. So for the next section, Richard will quickly talk about that.
Okay, so in the first half of the lecture, we were speaking about these vanilla RNNs. We were talking about backpropagating through time. You have your sequence, you have some hidden state, and you keep backpropagating through. And the important part, and the reason this is so different from normal backpropagation, is that we have those tied weights used at every step. All right. And so what happens is that we see when we make an update, we're making that update by doing the matrix multiplication and applying our activation function, right? We've said we have all our weights, we have our current state and our new input that we've stacked together, we multiply all of it together, and then we give that to the activation function. So in some sense, this update is multiplicative. We do all of it at once, the entire state is updated at once. So in these gated models, what we're trying to say is, rather than updating all of it at once in one step, we're trying to say, we're going to make some gates that update only little pieces at a time. And then we can decide which pieces we want to update. So, from the previous one, we have our state from the previous time step, our input, we go into our recurrent function, we get our next state, and we get some outputs from that. In this new one, we're trying to say, we have a scrap piece of paper over there, and that's going to be our memory, right? And then when we get a new input, and we get that state from the previous one, we can say, well, given this new input, maybe I should write something down, scratch something out, or update the piece of paper in some way, right? So maybe the bottom left corner is no longer useful, and you can tear that off, and you can stick something else on, and you can write there, right? And so the idea is that we can now make these changes in smaller chunks, in little bits and pieces. And then the question is obviously, well, how do we decide what to update, what to forget, what to remember, what to read out, which part of the paper do I show to the rest of the network? All of these different factors. And these are things that you need to think about when designing these more gated kind of architectures. So the first question is, what does a gate do? Okay. If it's closed, it stops things going through. If it's open, it lets things go through, right? Okay, so we are now gate experts. So fundamentally what we're saying is we have our piece of paper and our gate is going to tell us which stuff on the piece of paper do we forget? Okay? Which bits do we cross out or erase and we no longer care about that part of memory? And we're going to have one gate for that. We're going to have another gate to say, well, what is the stuff that we keep? What is the stuff that we add given what we've now seen? And then how much of the paper do we show if it's the rest of the net? Okay, those are the fundamental things that we're going to be thinking about. And so you can see in this image, we illustrating a write gate. So that's maybe saying write something down on a piece of paper. And so if you give me a completely random number into the network, so you give me 42, okay? If the write gate is on, right, then you write 42 down on a piece of paper. Right? If the write gate is off, then I don't write 42 on a piece of paper. Right? Then we could have a keep gate. And that says, well, stuff that's already written down, what do we keep? What do we get rid of? So some of it we want to we say forget that bit. Right? So if 42 was already written down and keep and the keep gate was on, then I would leave 42 where it is. Okay, we leave it on the piece of paper and we remember it. Right? If the keep gate is off, then we forget it. Okay, and we get rid of it. And then likewise, the read gate is saying, this is just one Lego piece and an entire Lego castle, right? And so we're saying, how much of this internal state do we want to show to the rest of the network? So we might find that it's useful to remember more information about what the state is, but we maybe don't need to share all of that information with whatever the rest of the network is doing. And so that reads that and say, how much do we actually send out? Right. And the idea here then is that we still want to be able to train these gates. We still want to be able to say we must be able to learn parameters that sometimes we remember and sometimes we forget. And so obviously we need to be able to backpropagate through the circuit. Okay. So we have a system where we move forward, right? And we keep some stuff and we write some stuff and we read some stuff out. And over this, we can see that there are a number of different gates, and we're going forward in time through our unit, and we'll remember some stuff. So right at the beginning, we forget what was there, and we write down the new number. Right? We don't read anything out. Then we go across, and now keepers become one. So now we say, don't throw away anything that's written down. We get some new information in, but write it off, so we don't bother with writing it down at all. Okay? And read is still zero, so we don't give anything out to the network. We then go across again, and we see keep is one, so we still leave it where it is. Write, we're not writing anything, so we don't need to touch it. And now we see that read is one, so we would take that value of 1.7, and we would send it out to the rest of the network, and that would go into SoftMax classifier, or it would go into any of the other layers that we've been speaking. I'd have to give that some thought, I'm afraid.
Okay.
Cool. Okay, so, yeah.
Question.
Yes.
Okay. What, can you just help with the intuition here about why, when are we going to decide to keep or read
okay.
that, and how that eventually affects the overall land weight?
Okay. So how do we decide when we keep some stuff and when we throw it away? And the whole point of all of this, right, is that we want to learn it. So we want to say we have sequences, and we want to learn when it's best to throw stuff away and when it's best to keep stuff. Right? And those functions, right, so whether we keep something or not, we can have a simple single-layer neural network. Right? So you have a whole bunch of weights that come in from your input, and based on the input and the previous state, you then decide which things you forget and which things you remember. Based on the input and your hidden state, you then decide which things you update. Based on your input and your hidden state, you decide which things you read out into the rest of the network. And so the point is that we want to learn all of those things. Okay? So that then gets us to our first problem. Right? At the moment, these gates are on or off. Right? And so it's discrete. Yeah? So what do we do when we want something that looks a bit discrete, but we still want it to be smooth and continuous? Second, right? So what we can do is we can say, well, this is just talking about going backwards, right? So we can say, well, we want them to be differentiable. We want them to be smooth. We want them to be bounded between 0 and 1, right? And that is like the ultimate case we're using simply, right? Okay. So then let's think about it. If we need a forget gate, how do we build a forget gate out of some sigmoid activation function? We just multiply it by whatever we're deciding to forget or not, right? And if the sigmoid gives us 0 times whatever was written down, it's now gone, right? We've forgotten it. And if the sigmoid gives us 1, then 1 times whatever it was is still 1, or still whatever it was, right? And so, so in essence, from going from a 0 up to a 1, and if we just train that sigmoid in the correct way, it's a very straightforward process to apply this forgetting or not forgetting. Okay, there's a question. Okay, so when we want to half forget. So what you could say is maybe one of the neurons in your hidden state or in your memory, maybe one of those neurons tells us something when it's very big and it's very small. And so maybe you would want to say we want it to shrink down, but we don't want to forget it completely. Right? And so this allows you to do that. Okay. Yes. So the idea is that you'll have some internal memory, right? And that internal memory, and I'll talk about it a little bit more on the next slide, but the internal memory will be a vector of length n, of some length. And then we'll say we want to remember certain bits from different positions in the vector. So your logical gates, you're talking about and or not, things like this. This is more of a how much information do we remember or forget, or how much information do we let through or not. Okay. Alright. So this idea of a forget gate is relatively straightforward. We just multiply by whatever value we're getting out of our sigmoid. Right? And I should probably preface this by saying we're now talking about a structure called the LSTM, long short-term memory. Okay? And the LSTM specifically has these three gates. Okay, so in the previous slides I was talking a little bit more generally, and now we are on a specific one. Okay, so in the LSTM we have this forget gate. We've said at the very beginning we want to forget some of the stuff that we've been keeping in memory. And what we decide to forget, how we do that, we base it on the previous state and our new input. Okay? And we do that in the exact same way that you would think we would. We concatenate our hidden state and our new observation. We have some weight, so we multiply those two matrices. And we have some bias. We feed it into the sigmoid function, and that gives us our result. The next gate that we have is the update gate. And the update gate says, well, we've got new information in. Right? We need to update whatever state we've got inside the cell. So we've made some new observation, we need to update the state. And so that part is very similar to what we had in the Manila RNA, right? We read in new information, we took the previous state, and we made some update. Okay? And so this one, we are saying, calculate some new value, and decide how much of that new value should be part of the new state, all right? So the gate on the update says, proposed new value, let some of it through into the state. Okay? And so we said with the vanilla RNN, it was this multiplicative thing where we just said in one big shot, replace the entire state. In this one, we're saying update bits of it. So maybe the update gate says update the first four numbers in the vector and then leave the other numbers as they were and then half update the one at the end. Okay? So we have a lot more flexibility over how we update that state. And then finally, we have a gate that says, well, now that we've got a state, how much of it do we actually let out into the rest of the network? And we'll come back to the slide afterwards, but let's rather step our way through an actual example of what it looks like, something a little bit easier to follow. So this is the LSTM, and you can see on the top left-hand side, we've got X and we've got the previous output, the previous hidden state. Right? So that's exactly as before. And we now have this other part of the state called C, which is our memory vector. That's the stuff we remember from time step to time step as well. So the first step, just for the RNN, we can concatenate them. Right? And so we just stack that. Sorry, the screen doesn't show red. Okay, we concatenate them. And so we now got that one input, so to speak. Right? That goes into the gate, right? And that gate has been trained. So that's got its own weights that we need to learn in the whole training process as well. And so that gate then decides, okay, how much of the previous stuff do we forget? Right? And so once we've calculated what that value of that gate is, we then say, okay, well, perform the actually forget stuff. Right? And so we take the memory from the previous step. So that's in C. And we simply multiply. We multiply the zero that we get from the sigmoid or the one that we get from the sigmoid or however much we want to keep or forget from there. Right. So the forget process is fairly straightforward. After that, we have the update process. Okay. And there are two parts to this. So the first one says, well, what is the proposed update? Right? And that's where we have the tan H. And there we can learn just like a normal, as you would in a normal neural network layer. And so you can do that updating whatever way is sensible. And more common than not, people are using the TAN action. And so you learn all your weights in there and you get some value out. And then you also hit it with a gate. And you say, how much of this new state do we actually want to keep? And so you do that by just multiplying them together, just as we did with the forget gate, and then you simply add it to your previous state. Right. So then we said we had a third gate. Oh, sorry. So you add it to your previous state, and that's actually given us our new memory. Right? So that's where we've actually gone and written something down on the paper. Okay. So from here, we say, okay, well, we probably want to give some output to the rest of the network, okay? We want to give the network some information that it can use to then go and classify or give us words or something like that, right? And so at this point, we now take the value from that memory, right? We apply tan H, okay? And we calculate some new result, okay? So again, this can be in whatever process you need, but we've applied tan H, and then we have another gate, we have our result gate, and we say how much of that are we actually letting through? So we may not want to let all of the information through, because maybe that makes it difficult to do other things. Okay. So maybe we want to hold back parts of it. And the bits that we decide to hold back, once again, we've trained using the single layer with the sigmoid. So why are we using tan H instead of the relu here? Yeah, it's the one that's used normally is tan H in everything that I've seen. Yeah. So that seems like a good question to ask Stefan. All right, so we'll find out and we'll come back. All right. So once again, we've now calculated our output, right? And we multiply by our gate, and that gives us the output of the cell. All right. And that output can then go into SoftBank classifiers or whatever other layers you're building the network from. All right, so that takes us back to the slide. Okay. So we've got our forget gate, we've got our update gate, we've got our read gate. Okay, forget, update, and then read is the output. Okay. We've calculated our new proposed state using the TANH. And there are a whole bunch of weights and biases that we can train in there as well. And then when we actually perform that update to C, it's just forget times the last state plus update times whatever the new proposed state was. All right. So the first thing to notice here then is that you can forget nothing and you can update completely. Right? There's no enforced link between the two. Right? Those two are completely independent. And so in this case, we've had to learn three different gates. And there's a new architecture as well called GRU. Right? And that's a gated recurrent unit. And that one uses two gates instead of three. And so in this one, you have a reset gate, and you have some update gate. And the update gate itself encodes how much you forget and how much you update together, right? And so you can see that we say x prime is that, right at the top, we say that x is our input data concatenated with our previous state. We then use that information to calculate the values of our two gates. Okay. Once we've calculated the value of our two gates, right, we now have R, which is that reset one. And that one goes in and it says, let's forget stuff from the previous state. Right? Forget your key. Okay. Based on that new data vector, we can then calculate a new proposed update. Right? So that's x prime prime. And once again, you use TANH. And then finally, when we're actually updating the state into our new time step, right, we're taking that gate Z and we're saying 1 minus Z so that we know what to forget, and we're saying Z to know what we add. And so we've linked those two together. So we've always got that sum will always be 1, right? Yeah, so you could certainly come up with different types of gates and different architectures for this, and there are lots of different ones. Although a lot of the research is showing that they're kind of evening out to be equivalent in many cases. And specifically, why we want this instead of like the vanilla RNN, right? Is that we're trying to train, and we'll see this when Stefan takes over soon. And when you try and backpropagate your error, you can backpropagate along that line in C, right? And you can have a gradient that doesn't get interrupted all the time. And that helps stop you getting vanishing gradients, which was that problem before. So now that we've got this one long continuous line of memory that can travel all the way through, it solves this vanishing gradient problem. And so the idea of these gated units and building all of these things together like this is specifically to try and get around those other problems associated with the vanilla RNN.
It sounds like yesterday, when you circumvent some gates with another line,
Yeah, maybe let's chat after.
So you did use the parallel networks, but see,
Yeah, and so could you write it as that difference equation? You probably could, but solving that difference equation is not always straightforward. And in this setup, you can solve it using the standard kind of backpropagation techniques that we've been talking about.
So even in the simplest current network, you can't—it's difficult to describe it in terms of current equation.
In very simple ones, you probably could. So in very simple ones, possibly. But the point is right that we're talking about deep networks, right? And so we're talking about building massive networks with lots and lots and lots of layers. And so, if you're talking about a network that's that simple, it's probably not sufficient to learn what you're trying to do.
So
right.
Even the component that deals with that couldn't be expressed. In other words, without worrying about all the other complexities or layers.
So as long as you can write it in a way that still allows for training, then it's fine. And whether you can do that or not will depend largely on how you structured that cell. Right. Okay. So the important thing with the GRU, right, is that you linked your update and your forget. Okay. And so that's the big takeaway we have from the GRU. And that it's obviously cheaper now, because now we've thrown out an entire gate and all the weights that we would have to learn. So Stefan will take over from here, and he's going to talk about the gradient flow and how we would actually train these things. And then from there, he'll discuss some applications as well.
Okay. Well, that was quite a mouthful. So the key takeaway with the gated architectures is this idea that the gates are some function we compute from the previous time step and the inputs that maps between 0 and 1. We use that to do this reading and writing thing. I just want to emphasize that the LSTM is, although it's almost 20 years old, or 17, 18 years old at the moment, it's very widely used because it was one of the first times that people were actually able to really train sequential models and get them to just really learn amazing stuff. The GRU only came out in about 2014. Kyung Yung Cho and Yoshua Benjio and colleagues worked on that. And I think once you start getting exposed to gated architectures, it's not a trivial concept to wrap your mind around. It's easiest to start from the simple idea of a read, a write, and a forget gate, and just combine those for a single cell and try to see how that allows the model to, like Richard said, keep a little scratch pad around and selectively add a few things to it and selectively scratch off a few things. How does it know what to scratch off? It's magic. Just, it learns how to do this. Very few people really understand LSTMs at a fundamentally deep level. You really just need to understand the basics in order to be able to apply this. But this concept of using gating is also used in other architectures. There are some architectures, for instance, someone mentioned what we had yesterday with the bypasses, what's called ResNets. There are also highway layers that some people have, which kind of uses gating and things like that. This concept is very powerful of having a gating function, which essentially is, again, the concept, the key thing to remember is it's the scalar multiplication between these individual gating units. So I have a vector, which is my memory vector. I compute these gates, and then I use each of these gates to multiply how much I attenuate or change these individual elements of the vector. And that is key to why this ends up being easier to train. And to see that, think back to when we talked about the vanilla RNN and how propagating back error signals becomes a multiplication of this WHH transpose. Remember? Can I just quickly finish this point and I'll get to your question. In the gated architectures, we have this is the fundamental part right here. So we have memory and we have new state. And the fundamental thing is we have the memory is essentially a forget gate, element-wise multiplied with this, the previous memory vector. So if we look at the top there, we have a memory vector at time step t, we have a memory vector at time step t minus 1, and we want to propagate back gradients in order to get gradients on all these parameters to train the model. The gradient of the output of with respect to ct is the derivative of ct with in this case it's the derivative of f multiplied by ct. What's the derivative with respect to ct of f multiplied by c? It becomes the forget gate. So if the model chooses to keep this gate at 1, it essentially has a gradient of 1 that it can basically pass all the way back, and this is what's illustrated by this line here. Originally in the original paper they talked about an error carousel. The idea is that this memory unit has a self-connection, which is linear, to itself, and when you do that gradient, the gradient becomes 1. So if it chooses to have the gate at 1, the gradient becomes the value of the gate. So if the model chooses to have this gate at 1, we have this constant uninterrupted flow of gradient all the way through the back, through the network. And that's the key difference of why you're able to train these gated models for many, many, many more time steps than you're able to do with a vanilla RNA. Because think back again, with the vanilla RNA, the gradient of the previous time step with of the current with respect to the previous is this inverse matrix multiplication. And we talked about the issues if the singular values of this multiplication are larger or smaller than 1. You have exploding or vanishing gradients. In this case, the model essentially controls how much of that gradient it needs to let through. So in essence, it can actually pass the gradients all the way back to the first time step. The rest of it is a little bit of magic, and you just need to believe in it and try it for a few times. There was a question at the back there. That's a question you should ask Jeffrey Hinton. He would love to talk to you about that for a very long time. I am definitely not enough of a neuroscientist to be able to answer that question sufficiently well. We might have some people in the audience who could add to that, but at a very high level, I think based on spiking patterns and the amount and response time, people have kind of gotten to the point where at least some people believe that most intelligent tasks shouldn't require more than 10 or 20 steps of processing. So my guess would be that the brain probably doesn't have something like this. This is a highly engineered solution. In fact, it is a highly unintuitive thing the first time you get exposed to this. I would be surprised probably if there is some biological equivalent to that.
All right, so could you just talk very quickly through the kind of number of parameters in that?
Yes,
space?
Very good point. That's actually what I wanted to say as well. So we talked about two architectures. We talked about the LSTM, we talked about the GRU. And Richard mentioned that the LSTM has these three gates, and the GRU has two gates, which are tied. And the important thing to keep in mind is that these gates are actually vectors of the same dimensionality as your human state, because and as the memory. So what does that mean in terms of the number of parameters that you need for your model? Because that gate is another little neural network, right? It has its own W forget H, which maps from H to the forget gate, and it has its own W update or whatever gate it is that you're working with. So in terms of number of parameters, the more gates you have, the number of parameters actually increases linearly. And this is also a big deal for memory consumption issues. So the GRU is cheaper, and in practice, I would probably just advise you to start with the GRU, because it's cheaper, and on most tasks, you end up probably getting roughly similar results. So now we're going to switch a little bit to the more fun part of the talk, which is applications. We spent a lot of time kind of developing the intuition behind sequential models. We talked about this idea of different classes or types of tasks where I have several inputs that I want to map to several outputs, or one to many, or many to one. Let's have a concrete look at some of these. And specifically, I'll be talking about image captioning. And this is the first time I saw this work was quite phenomenal. It's this application of the same technology that we use for many other things. You feed the model an image, and it spits out a sentence which kind of describes what's in the image. No, that doesn't mean you've solved AI. You still need a training set that's annotated with images and labels. You can get those things on the web, but it's still quite a magical thing when you have a model that can take in an image and kind of give you a sentence that describes what's in the image. We'll also talk about sequence classification. And what is this? What does this mean? This means I give you a sequence, X's, and you should label the entire sequence as belonging to some kind of class. This is things like polarity prediction. I give you a sentence and I ask you if it's positive or negative. This is things like spam prediction. This is something that we have in the practical, which is I give you an image and you chop up the image into little bits and I feed it to you one at a time. You need to remember what you've seen in order to tell me what is the object in the image. In our case, mnist, so it's a digit. And we'll talk about language modeling, and language modeling is very important. Language modeling is building a statistical model that can understand the structure of language, in a sense. It is building a model that can, if I show the model a piece of a few words, the model can tell me this sequence of words is more likely than that sequence. If this model has been trained adequately, it would say the cat sits on the mat is much more likely than the mat sits on the cat, for instance, because it hasn't seen the other one really in training that much. And then we'll talk about this big one, sequence. We'll first talk about sequence labeling. This is a very, very big field, actually. This is a big part of natural language processing tasks, can be mapped as sequence labeling. The idea is I give you a sequence of words, a sentence, and you should tell me various properties of these words. So again, it's this one-to-one output of number of inputs to number of outputs. Each input has an output. There's a lot of tasks that fit this bill. We'll talk about that and show an example. And then we'll get to sequence to sequence. Who in this audience has heard of sequence to sequence? Okay. Sequence to sequence was really a big breakthrough for all of these kinds of sequential models and popularizing them. And it really only happened in 2014. It was 3 years ago that Kwok Lee and Ilya Sutskever and Oriol Vignals were working together, and they were trying to solve the problem of how do we map input sequences to output sequences. And we'll talk a little bit about it. We'll just give the intuition about that. But this is for tasks like machine translation and things like that. Ends up being useful for many other things as well. So image captioning. This is a one-to-many problem. We have an image, and we're trying to predict the labels for it. Historically, I should say that the sequence-to-sequence learning actually came first. When they made that breakthrough, they realized that you can actually train a model to generate these kinds of sequential, to map from sequences to sequences. And then you start thinking about things like it's an encoder-decoder architecture. So if I encode data, I can map it into a space, then I have a decoder which can decode back into a new space. You can generalize that concept a little bit and say, why do I need to use an input sequence of words? What if I feed it an image? I can just encode the image and then map it back into the sequence of words. So historically, these two actually were reversed, but I show this first because it's an example of one to many. And in a nutshell, the way this works is very simple. We talked about convolutional neural networks earlier. You could use any kind of model, that you can use to map an input image to a fixed size vector. So you could use a feed-forward model, but what's the issue with that? We have an explosion of parameters because we have fully connected architecture. So you could probably use a convolutional neural network, and for this, people tend to pre-train the convolutional networks. Yesterday there was a question when Jan was talking about, you know, how do people apply these things to different tasks. Most people pre-train these convnets on ImageNet to learn to predict one of 1,000 different classes. It turns out this thing, this pre-trained model, has a lot of really useful features that it actually learns. The layer just before the softmax. If you consider this convolutional net, you feed it, you train it on ImageNet, it propagates upwards, you have a final layer, and then it maps to the softmax, which says which class is this, does this image belong to. You chop off the softmax, and you just use this model as an encoder. You freeze the weights. So now you can feed it an image. The interesting thing is you don't have to feed it images that are from ImageNet. You can feed it a man with a straw hat, for instance. And this network will have learned enough about the structure of objects in images in order to encode these with really useful feature representations. The next bit is you can add on top of that the decoder that we've been talking about. So some recurrent decoder. Yes? Right. I mean, that's a very good question. Of course, I cannot tell you the answer to that. I can venture a guess, but my best guess is ImageNet is, there's a lot of crazy stuff in ImageNet as well, if you actually go and look at the data. But it is a reasonably diverse set of examples and of images. There are things like cats, and there's dogs, and there's cars, and there's planes, and there's a lot of them. So a model needs to learn certain patterns of the visual world, which repeats itself. Things like, you know, translation invariance, it doesn't matter where the object is. Rotation, things can rotate, but it's still the same object. It needs to try to it does learn properties that are actually useful for describing general pictures in general. So you take this pre-trained convnet, you pass the image through it, you map it up to some penultimate layer. Now this is your description of the input. Now all we do is, we take a recurrent neural network. So this is our recurrent net. This is the hidden state. This is the output that it produces. And during training, we know what the description is. So we unroll this network, and we give it the real words that it's supposed to predict. The model has some prediction. We show it the real word, and we compute some kind of error. Minimize it, and we backpropagate all the way to the final hidden layer. So we don't have to train the CNN. If you have a lot of data, you could try that as well, but you don't have to. So what we really need to do is we need to train this model to be able to take descriptions from the CNN, which we know are generally useful, to predict the labels that we see in the training set. It sounds somewhat complicated, but if you think of it in terms of encoders and decoders, it's actually pretty straightforward. And it works quite well. Of course, it doesn't always work, but these are some examples that I took, and I believe these are cherry-picked. But some of them are actually pretty good. We have this guy, boy is doing backflip on wakeboard. I don't think there's actually a wakeboard in there, but it makes total sense. You could imagine someone doing a backflip. This one says two young girls are playing with Lego toy. Construction worker in orange, safety vest, is working on road. I don't think that's a road, it might be something else, but again, it got the construction worker. And a man in black shirt is playing guitar. That one seems reasonable. But again, I guess the key takeaway here is that none of this stuff was engineered for this task. This is why people got excited about applying deep learning technology to really difficult tasks like image captioning. If I ask you now to come up with a model that does image captioning, you would have to really think hard about how an image is structured, how can I extract features that would be useful, how can I then go from these features to predict sentences. These sentences can be different lengths. This is kind of a generic architecture that on first application, Orion Vinyals, I think he did this the first time, he literally just took his sequence-to-sequence model and just applied it to images. It was like, wow, this works. And of course, there's been people who's improved on this since then, but that is kind of why people get excited about this stuff. An example of many-to-one, sequence classifiers. We've talked about this already. I've given some intuition. We did not talk about how you feed words into a neural network. But, you know, in a nutshell, you convert words to vectors. That's essentially what you do. Because these neural networks are continuous space models, so you need to map these discrete words into vectors. It's kind of the opposite thing of what you do when you predict labels. Labels are these discrete labels, and we convert them to vectors in the softmax function, if you think about it. The features in the softmax are actually vectors describing the labels. It's just kind of the first thing. So many-to-one examples are, for instance, I give you a sentence and I ask you, is this an example of someone saying something positive or negative? That's sentiment classification, polarity detection. Or is it a neutral statement? Email, I feed you the words and I ask, is it spam? Now, I'm not saying that a recurrent neural network is the best way to actually use spam classification. In fact, for all of these things, I would always recommend that you start with the simplest thing, which would be for words, a bag of words representation. Just throw away all the sequential information. Try to train a linear regression model to tell you if it's spam or not. See how well you do, then add a layer in there. See how well you do, and then maybe start adding sequence information. Yes? I'm sorry, I can't hear.
With regards to image captioning, how do you evaluate that you have good caption for it?
You use a supervised training set. All of the examples that we showed today are examples of supervised learning. So I know how well my model is doing based on its loss on the training set. The lower the loss, the better it's doing. How do I know how well it's doing in the wild? That's a different question. That's sort of post-training evaluation. I could ask people to rate it, for instance. That's what we do with machine translation. Metrics and evaluation is a very important question. How do we, loss functions are great, right? Negative log likelihood is a great loss function. It does the right thing, but it's not all you need. Sometimes, for instance, with translation, you care about the quality. The quality might not necessarily be 100% reflected in the training loss or the loss of the objective that you're optimizing. There we do things like blue score evaluation. But even blue score evaluation is just an approximate metric function that says how many n-grams overlap between what your model predicted and what a human would predict. It's kind of a rough score because, again, you're kind of discretizing this idea of what is a good prediction. But it's a very important topic is coming up with better ways of evaluating the outputs of models. At this point, just to finish up on that point, at this point, the best thing we have, since we're trying to do human-level tasks, it ends up with a lot of these things. Best option you have is really just asking a human to rate it.
So I have a question that's a follow-up on that. Let's say for the same image, I have multiple captions, so I describe the image differently, but I mean, you know, when you assume it's
yeah.
With it, they all make sense. So how do you evaluate it then?
Well, you'll train on your different examples. If you have a lot of data, then the model will eventually learn to come up with creative captions. So what I didn't say here was actually, I didn't want to go into too much detail, but the way that this works is you take an image, you input it, you get a hidden state, and then we decode from the hidden state. We didn't cover this, so I'll just mention it at a high level. During training, we know what these words should be because you told me what they are.
Yeah.
They're labeled, the images are labeled. So I can minimize the loss of the model on the given labels. But at inference time, I want to generate from the model. Right? How do we do that? Well, what this model is essentially describing is it's describing a probability distribution. It's giving you a distribution over next word given image, next word given previous words and image, next word given previous words and image. So it kind of builds up this joint probability distribution. So what you can do is you feed in this final hidden state and then I forward propagate through my model that was trained to predict one of vocabulary number of words, right? Does that make sense? And then I sample from that. So I take I randomly sample one word from that. And this will give you different outputs for different images the whole time, but they will all be reasonably likely under the model that you've trained. Or you can just do greedy decoding and pick the maximum likelihood one at every point. They'll always give you one, but that's the point. So to answer your question, you train on all the variations that you have, and at test time, you sample so your model can surprise you.
So
that can be a good thing and a bad thing.
If it were to happen in my these captions that I have, let's say that you had a lot of these images with people wearing hats, and you know, a small proportion of those are actually rolled, the person is also wearing a hat. In other words, maybe I talked about the tree and the person and so on and so on.
Yeah.
Does that mean that when we're sampling from this thing, then there would be a small probability that it would talk about the hat, because in the when we're training it, there was a small probability, basically, talking about the hat.
Yeah.
The
so I think you're talking about two things there. So yes, the model will end up learning the maximum likelihood model. So whatever you know occurs, it will predict things with the frequency with which it observed during training, roughly speaking. The other point you raised was if we have misclassified examples. So this is talking about data quality. Having misclassified examples. So let's say we have images where people are not wearing hats, but it's labeled as the one, you know, person with straw hat or whatever. You always want to get the cleanest data possible, but actually it turns out in practice a lot of these models are reasonably robust to noise in the data. So for instance, we'll talk about machine translation in a little bit. Actually, we need to probably move on and get to that. But with machine translation, for Google Neural Machine Translate, we ended up training on a lot of data that was automatically collected, because it's expensive to get people to tell you this is the English version, that's the French version. And despite the fact that there were noise in the data, the model still ends up learning surprisingly good relationships. Okay, so we were talking about this many-to-one idea, so polarity detection or span detection or images. How does this work in a sense? Well, just briefly, let's say we're trying to do polarity, to sentiment classifier. Is what I'm saying good or bad? I will train my model by inputting words at each time step. I'll use the final hidden state of my recurrent network to be a representation for the sentence. And now I just train a classifier on top of that vector. So I just train a binary classifier that says positive or negative, or one that has neutral in there as well as softmax. But that's essentially the model. That's how it works if you implement it as a sequence model. Same thing works for span detection. We have the words, we input them in the model, and we should predict whether it's spam or whether it's ham. Again, this is probably not the best model that you should use for spam detection, because certain words are very strongly correlated to being spam and could probably tell you whether the message was spam. But this is how you would do this kind of thing. And then the same thing can be done for images. And I'm not sure if we will end up getting to that point today in the practical, but you can treat an image as a sequence of pixels. You can scan an image row by row, for instance, and feed in one row or a couple of rows or a chunk of the image to the network at each time step, and then predict at the end what is the label. We talked about language modeling. That's next word or next token prediction is what language modeling is. Just at a high level, it relates to the comment I had earlier about where you put the labels. In language modeling, we're trying to learn this joint distribution of all the words. We're trying to figure out what is the statistical structure of language. And we restructure this joint as this product of conditionals. So I can say that the probability of observing word 1, word 2, word 3, word 4, all the way up to word m, is this decomposition, it's the product of seeing the first word, given nothing, times the product of seeing the second word, given the first word, times the product of the probability of seeing the third word, given 1 and 2, and so forth, all the way up to the previous word. And this right there is directly a neural network. This probability distribution, we just represent as the, I feed in a word, and I have a prediction, and it's a recurrent model, so if I get to the next word, it remembers what it has seen so far. So I feed in a new word, and then I can predict the next word given all the words that I've seen so far. And you can train this in a way to optimize for next word prediction, and And then you can score language, pieces of language to say, is this likely, is it not likely? Language modeling is hugely important because it's used in speech recognition, it's used in machine translation, it's used to, during a search process, if you want to generate language during a search process, you can use a language model to throw out garbage that the model might be producing. Because the language model will tell you if it's even a likely sentence to begin with. Sequence labeling. So again, in this case, we're mapping from many to many, but each input has a label. So in NLP, lots of tasks follow this pattern. I give you words, and it would be useful for me to know which parts of speech they correspond to. For instance, I give you a sentence. Is this a verb? Is it a noun? Is it a determiner? What is it? Name entity recognition, roughly the same thing, but now we want to identify the mentions in text, so even more than one word, that mentions people, places, organizations. So we should label spans of text as whether it refers to people, organizations, or text. And then semantic row labeling is something called shallow parsing, where I'm trying to figure out what are the semantics of a sentence. If I say John hit Mary, it's probably a terrible example, then you know, there's an actor, there's a theme, which is what was being done, and then there is the party to which it was done. And these are the relationships that semantic parsing, shallow semantic parsing, try to extract. So just concretely, for part of speech tagging, if I give you a sentence like heat water in a large vessel, the goal is to match each of these words to one and only one of the part of speech tags. A noun, a verb, a preposition, a determiner, or an adjective. And although this is largely a solved task in NLP, just to understand why this would be a difficult thing, you'd probably think, why is this difficult? Just have a dictionary and it'll tell me it's a noun or it's a verb. But it turns out if you have sequences where you try to predict certain labels with uncertainty, then the size of the set that you're uncertain about ends up multiplying the total possibilities exponentially. So this is why in HMMs we have things like Viterbi to find the optimal decodings, because the combinations from one state to the next, in this case one label to the next, can quickly explode exponentially. And that's how you would do it. Network. I probably want to wrap up with sequence-to-sequence modeling. I put it at the end because it's kind of the most general one, but again, as I said, historically it kind of came first. It was, in my opinion, quite a significant breakthrough. This idea that people didn't know how to apply neural networks to sequences of words. It was not intuitive, and people were trying and they failed. Until in 2013, people started discussing, revisiting almost this idea of autoencoders. If you think about an autoencoder, if you've ever heard about this, then essentially it's a bottlenecked architecture. So it takes an input, it compresses it, and then it tries to reconstruct it. So you push information through some bottleneck. And people were saying, and it was hugely successful at the time, as a feed-forward model. So unsupervised learning, I train a model that just tries to learn the distribution of the data. And then someone started asking, well, again, you know, thinking of these individual components as Lego blocks, people started asking, why do we need to have a feedforward model? What if we just put a recurrent model in there? And that's how they came to this idea of mapping sequences to sequences. Only it turns out, when you do this in practice, and this was specifically tried for machine translation at the time. If you do this in practice, it comes down to the following thing. You have an encoder RNN, this is the light green section here, and this reads your source text, and it maps it to some vector. And then you have a decoder RNN, and this reads the vector produced by the encoder RNN, and maps it to a sequence again. The problem is, it was not entirely obvious at all that it would be able to take entire sentences and just compress them into a vector of length 50, 100 real numbers. In fact, taking another step back 2 years before that, we
we were grappling with the issue of, can we represent words from different languages? Not even the sentences, just words in the same space, so that words that mean the same thing end up being close to each other. And once that idea clicked, people were thinking about sequences. And just to give you an idea of roughly of the chronology of this, the three guys that were working on this, they spent the better part of a year to try to make it work. It was literally not just the case of taking machine translation data, feeding it into a model, getting a vector, and then generating an output. It was tremendously difficult to get the model to capture the relevant information that was necessary to produce anything longer than five words, because the model would just forget, right? Or it would just remember the last things. It turns out that there were two things that ended up making this really useful. The first thing was, at some point, someone said, well, if the model is having trouble with learning these long-range dependencies between generating this sentence, the word blue in French and the word blue in English, it's kind of the case that, you know, words later on in the English sentence are kind of related to words later on in the French sentence. In that, for that language pair, it's true. So he's like, why don't we just reverse this, the target sentence? And this idea actually made it work, because all of a sudden the correlations, the lengths of the correlations you had to learn, the long-term dependencies, were much smaller. Once they got that to work, simultaneously someone else came up with an idea which is called attention, which is something that I won't go into detail, but essentially it's allowing the model to peek at the entire input during the generation of the output. It can attend to parts of the input. And those two, the first thing was a trick, so it got people to believe that this idea could work. But the second one was a very general solution to this issue of long-term dependencies. And it's being used everywhere. Attention is used everywhere. In fact, there's a recent paper out that we were joking about yesterday, which is called Attention is All You Need. And it's a very general concept. But this worked. The first research paper was published in 2014 at MIPS. Worked on WNT, which was at that point a reasonably small data set. And then a significant amount of effort had to be put into that in order to scale that up to be really useful. They got good academic results, which matched the previous systems. But to really make it useful, it required the efforts of many, many engineers and people to work on these systems over at least 1 year, until in September 2016, at least at Google, were able to release the Google Neural Machine Translation System, which was a tremendous step forward in terms of translation accuracy, and has continues being improved. And at that point, I should probably wrap up, but I'll take one question quickly.
Is it much easier to recognize which language, you know, there's an option in Google Translate to say just recognize the language?
Oh, yes. So language identification is reasonably is easy. It's, in fact, you can train a language classifier on character level information. So I can just feed it a couple of, you know, take your input sentence as a string and just scan a window of three characters over it and feed that to even a logistic regression model, a little bit more complex model, and you'll get reasonable accuracy in the high 90s of being able to predict what language it is. The last thing I wanted to quickly mention was dialogue modeling. This is also something that I worked on last year. You can use this same system. You can use a sequence-to-sequence model and train it on the prompts. So someone, you can imagine dialogue as a sequence of turns, right? I say something to you, you say something to me. So there's always this input-output relationship. This is a very trivial way of modeling dialogue, and a lot of, you know, people who work on dialogue will not like me for that statement, but it's as a first step you can do, make that assumption. And then you can train a sequence-to-sequence model on it. And we train a model, and it's just phenomenal how using LSTM networks with attention, the basic system, ends up learning really, really interesting outputs. So I'm just showing a few here. We said you can't eat pasta every day. You can't live only on Italian food. And a standard model, a baseline we looked at, said, I don't eat Italian food, but I do eat a lot of Italian food. That doesn't sound very good. And this is an issue that you actually have when you train sequence-to-sequence models and you decode them. The model ends up trying to really give you the high probability words. It
doesn't optimize for coherency, so there's a lot of kind of garbage and it'll repeat itself. But with a few bits and tricks, very simple tricks, we ended up getting things like, what do you have planned tonight? The baseline would say, I have no idea what I want to do with my life. I have no idea what I want to do. And our writers said that's pretty bad. With a few tweaks, we were able to kind of get this result, which I think is kind of creative and has some longer term correlations. And there's another one. So with that, I just quickly want to summarize the key takeaways. I think we've gone a little over time. We talked about RNNs, and we talked about how these are stateful models. An RNN has state, it has memory. It is able to memorize what it has seen so far in the sequence in order to predict what the outputs. We showed how the forward propagation part of an RNN comes down to really unrolling this graph over time in order to do the forward activations. And we said that you need to cache all of these intermediate activations, so it is fairly expensive for longer sequences. So we talked about backprop through time, and the key takeaways with that is that it uses the chain rule over this unrolled graph, but it uses it efficiently by saving the computations it has already computed. Like we said with that example of 1 and 2, and I mean, I'm not going to try to do that again because I'll get it wrong again. If you save what you've done so far, you don't have to recompute it, and that's what backprop does. But the gradient ends up being a sum over all time steps because all these weights are shared. And we talked about vanishing exploding gradients. We said exploding gradients is not a big deal really because you can just clip it and you can rescale it. But gated architectures, to a large extent, really solve the vanishing gradient problem. We talked about the memory requirements of LSTM, which is higher than GRU. We saw that GRU is a simpler model. It's a much more recent model. It's probably the one that you want to start out with if you start playing with these things. And then we looked at some cool applications. Yeah, that's it for now.